Thank you everyone for attending our session today. My name is Mark Lee and I am the Senior VP of Services for Solex Technologies. I'm just going to give a brief introduction to our session and I'll introduce our panelists. So Solex is a leading provider of enterprise data management solutions like database archiving, test data management, and application retirement. This is a panel discussion, so we want to encourage questions. So if you'd look at your WebEx panel, you'll notice my name, Mark Lee. So I'm going to be the moderator. And if you could use the chat function on WebEx to send me your questions, when we get the Q&A section of the presentation or of the session, then I will direct those questions back to the panelists. So I appreciate your cooperation on that. So, what exactly is application retirement and why are we talking about this? So applications, like you all know, are like any other technologies. They go through a very predictable life cycle. You know, it starts out with a business problem that leads to either a selection of an application or a development of a custom application, followed by an implementation and a maintenance phase. Then the application is in production for potentially many years where data builds up over time. And finally, at the end of the life cycle, it's time for the application to be retired. And what exactly causes that that end point? Maybe it's the business needs to implement a new business process, adopt new technology, move to a new application platform. So those are some of the drivers that that we see that are bringing this topic of application retirement to the fore. So the most common thing that we see in terms of driving application retirement in an organization are companies that have decided to move to a new application platform. So maybe they've made a strategic decision, for example, to move to a platform like SAP or Oracle E-Business Suite or some other custom application to replace the old systems to improve their business processes. Another scenario might be a merger or an acquisition where two companies come together, end up with a redundant set of applications and a need to remove some of the duplicate applications to reduce costs. A similar scenario might be a divestiture where a company decides to exit a business line and ends up with an application that they no longer need. So in each of these scenarios, companies are left with applications that are not needed for day-to-day running of the business, running of their production, but these applications continue to incur costs, and these costs may come in the form of structure costs, data center charges, hardware maintenance contracts, software license costs, software support costs, and even personnel costs. Now, it'd be great if you could just switch and have all these old applications just disappear and all the costs that are associated with them just be removed instantaneously from the IT budget. But in many cases, that may not be possible. So for example, you know, what if you still need access to the data and reports that are in these old applications for audit, for tax, for compliance reasons? Or what if you need access to the product and customer data in the application to support your warranty process or your customer support process? Or what if you just want to maintain access to the data to perform reporting and analytics? So unfortunately, for many applications, just flipping the switch and turning them off is not really an option. So what are the options? What should we do? And that is really the topic that we'll be exploring today with our panel of industry leaders. So each of these leaders has recently dealt with these issues of application retirement in their respective companies and have agreed to share their experiences and expertise with us today. So I want to thank each of them for agreeing to do that. And without further delay, let me ask each of the panelists to introduce themselves and their companies. Tell us a little bit about what you do as a company and your role in the organization. And let me start with Mark Parmet.
Mark, thank you very much, and good morning, everyone, and apologies for the ambient road noise in advance. I'm the Senior Director of Global IT Transformation in Finance for Avery Dennison. Avery Dennison is a Fortune 500 corporation with revenues last year in excess of $6 billion. We operate in 50 countries globally, and we are the market leaders in label and packaging. Just by way of anecdotal reference, virtually every label you have on your clothing right now has been manufactured and distributed by Avery Dennison. We are the market leader in consumer labeling and packaging as well. Most road signs that you see globally are made with Avery Dennison products. So even though we may not be a household name, I can say almost literally and figuratively there you touch an Avery Dennison brand built product every day of the year. So my responsibility is for a global transformation of our finance solutions, platforms, development, implementation, and support.
Great. Thank you, Mark. Let me now move to Gary Frederick.
Yeah, hello. Thanks, Mark. Gary Frederick here. I'm the Global Vice President of Application Services, primarily responsible for our engineering, manufacturing, our legacy, more legacy or more mature applications, which we call Tier 2, and as well as the decommissioning, which would be the data retention piece for Stanley Black & Decker.
Great, thank you. And Richard Elnicki.
Hi, I'm a project manager working for Santander UK. Santander is a global bank, one of the largest in the world. But my remit is just the UK.
Great. Well, thanks again to each of you. And let's jump into some discussion about your situation. I wanted to start with having each of you talk about the business problem that you encountered in your organization as it relates to application retirement, and then we'll go from there. So let me start again with Mark, and we'll rotate the order as we go through these.
Thank you, Mark. So our journey began late last summer. We had a series of end-of-life applications on our global finance platform side. We had a series of challenges, I think all of which Mark enumerated in his opening. We certainly have applications that have reached their natural end of life, both from in terms of usability and support. We have had an aging infrastructure on those platforms, as well as annual maintenance support and personnel support. Additionally, we have tax, risk compliance, and retrieval requirements across our business, and by that I mean most of the countries in which we business and report. We had significant risk compliance and tax and audit requirements that had to be met or exceeded. So with that in mind, we began our journey last summer with going out to Gartner, understanding who among the Magic Quadrant would be interested in talking to and engaging. We struck out on a rather extensive bit of functional requirements, and I guess from a guide point for everyone on the phone, I don't think you can invest enough time in great requirements. I think you build a house with a strong foundation, and everything really sort of runs downhill from there. So I think one of the things that we were able to do to our credit was have really crisp, clear, concise, comprehensive, and very credible functional requirements from which we could begin that journey.
Great.
Mark, would you like me to go further or hold off for the moment?
Well, we're going to dive deep into this with a bunch of additional questions. So let's hold there. And Gary, could you describe the business problem that you guys were facing at Stanley Black & Decker?
Yeah, very similar problem. You know, we recognize, you know, data is an important asset to our corporation, and as assets like any asset gets retired, systems are the same thing. We need to retain that data for compliance and coined all those things in the beginning. And we were doing a fair job, but, you know, the job wasn't repeatable, it wasn't predictable, and so we wanted to make sure that we had a strategy, make sure that we had the proper governance around the actual retention for data, and that we pursue this thing with the same zeal that we would pursue any other project that had investment involved. So that's when we struck out on our search for a product to help us. And
great.
I see you go through a question. So.
Okay. Excellent. And Richard, same question to you.
I think it's very, very much ditto, really. Santander tend to acquire banks, so when they do that, they rationalize systems. So we do end up with, for instance, Alliance and Leicester was one of the banks that it acquired. A lot of the Alliance and Leicester functionality, or most of it, eventually is incorporated into existing Santander systems. So those Alliance and Leicester systems that used to contain the data, you know, become redundant, and we, like the other guys, we end up with systems that hold data that for regulatory purposes we need to be able to access, but fairly infrequently. So I think that was our initial driver. We wanted something that we could use that would be consistent to archive those systems.
Excellent. Well, thank you. So the next topic that I wanted to get into was about the selection of the applications that were part of the project. So not only which applications did you decide to retire and decommission, but of those applications, how did you determine, you know, which ones you needed to retain the data or archive the data so that it could be preserved for use by the business, the auditor, the tax teams? And let me start on this one with Gary.
We established a roadmap based on our strategic plan, I guess the planning horizon of 3 to 5 years, and have a goal to be platform on specific systems, and that drives a lot of the retirement of applications. And along those lines, we have acquisitions that divestitures going on at the same time. And based on the actual assessment of risk in some cases with older applications, we looked at the capability of having people and staff retained, that we would lose the knowledge of actually looking at what the data was and how that data played together to give us information. And we looked at the actual viability of each application. Would it no longer be supported by, let's say, the supplier of the software? All those things pulled together into a plan, and the plan has then been put together so that we actually have a footprint that we look at from a decommissioning standpoint and a decommissioning program.
Great. And Richard, same question to you.
We had quite a large list of candidates initially, and we went through an analysis phase of looking at each one, assessing costs, and I think very much like Gary, ultimately come down to a decision as to is it appropriate to archive in Solix or looking at usage, costs, and those sorts of things. So that's basically how we come to a decision as to which ones we want to archive.
Excellent, Mark.
Yes. So thanks, Mark. So Gary and Richard, I think enumerated some. We had a multifaceted challenge. One was we had fairly rigorous timelines, especially around our global financial solutions. Secondly, we were in search of, because we have grown primarily through acquisition over the last 80 years, as you might imagine, quite a federated set of legacy applications. And we're really in search of a platform that we could then leverage further as the need and the business requirements warranted to be able to retire applications along the way. And thirdly, a very strategic initiative that wherever feasible and wherever meaningful, and practical to be able to start to move towards cloud as a platform. So all those kind of converged into what we came to know as Project SR2, which is an acronym for Store, Retrieve, and Report.
That's an interesting acronym. Okay, excellent. I'm going to combine the next two questions into one because they're very related to one another. So I'd like to have each of you talk about the alternatives you considered, including, you know, did you look at doing something in-house as a custom solution? Did you look at commercial products like ours? What were all the alternatives you considered to deal with this business problem? And then talk a little bit about your selection and why you made that selection. And let me start this one with Mark.
Thanks, Mark. So I guess the old adage is true, fast, cheap, and good, pick any two. I think we were looking for something that was not only a platform that we could rapidly deploy, but also was very cost efficient. And again, that would allow us our core requirements, and since it's a finance system and set of applications, the immutability of data was absolutely key. And the other core requirement is that, especially with our European requirements, is that the data in archive must be validated as being absolutely at parity with what was once our production system. That is, there can be no deviation whatsoever between what our production level data was and our archival solution to be. So the journey began, as I alluded to before, with our looking at Gartner, looking out at the Magic Quadrant to seeing who the industry leaders were, and to take a look at what those solution sets might offer. I think one of the things that was appealing from the outset is that Solex had, first and foremost, an integrated set of technologies and services. Avery Dennison is very very encouraged by the idea of being able to run alongside projects. That is, we have invested a lot in capital projects, so our ability to be able to bring in third-party trusted partners, whether they are large-scale systems integrators or domain experts to help us achieve our goal is something that we look at very carefully. We try to stick to our knitting, as they say. We try to stick to what it is that we do, that it continues to be our core competency, and wherever possible, taking partners that they can add value toward that end. So I think in terms of the immutability of data, the ability to deploy something very rapidly, to be able to have the kind of flexibility in terms of retrieval and reporting, and to be able to host our initial solution in the cloud were all core criteria.
Great, thank you. Gary, what alternatives did you guys consider, and tell us why you went the way you did?
Pretty similar approach. We do an onion investment. We took a very strong look. We consulted some of the sources in the industry like Gartner and so forth. We took a look at 3 to 4 other competitors to Solex, and I'll leave the names out, but we also looked at an internal solution where we kind of roll our own. After looking at all these against the criteria that we've established, and we had specific criteria that we needed, being able to standardize. And, of course, cost is always an option. So we ran down that road, and quite frankly, so there is a combination of offerings out there that are just services. Some are services and software, some are services and the capabilities that they provide are not as robust as others, as you might imagine. We came to a medium where we feel we've got the best value for our dollar, and that is, as Mark articulated, the providing service as well as the software base, and that what's led us to the solution for the selection.
Thanks, Gary. Richard?
We never considered an in-house solution. We went we had a short list of third parties. We narrowed that down to two companies, Solix and one other very well-known company, and we conducted a proof of concept. So we had a taste of what those two companies could provide, and ultimately, I think like Gary, we thought Solix was the best value for money all round in terms of perhaps the functionality that it offered and cost, and we're pleased we made that decision.
Great, thanks to all of you for that. So now that you have you've defined your business problem, you've looked at your alternatives, you made your selection of how you want to proceed, let's shift gears and talk about how you actually got the project up and running and got buyout from your end users and were able to get the project funded. So I want to combine two questions here. One is having to do with end users. As we all know, in a perfect world for a lot of end users, they'd like to be able to just continue to access an application and all the functionality that comes with that application and not have to worry about an archive or learning to run new reports and things like that. So I'm curious how you sold this approach of archiving legacy data to your end users, and then also how did you build a business case to move forward with the project? And let me start on this one with Richard.
I think from my perspective, we were quite fortunate in that we had a very senior business person who sponsored Solix from the word go. So with that sort of backup, it was quite easy to sell Solix, later on I'll probably describe how far we've got, but it's quite widely used now within the group. One of the things that I like about it is, in some respects, its simplicity, because I think, maybe as you hinted, quite often business users don't want to let go of the systems that they're currently using. And Solix, is a bit of a change to perhaps what they're used to. I tend to actually provide a demonstration of Solix to the business users at the outset of each project, so they know very early on this is what it looks like, and in the main they seem to accept that, and it doesn't seem to be too much of a problem.
Great, and did you have to build a business case come up with a return on investment to be able to get the project funded, or was that your process?
We did have a business case, but Solix has moved on since then, because that was for the initial implementation of Solix, and our initial project there were actually 10 systems that we were archiving. We've now implemented some in the region of 20 systems, and Solix is just now regarded as the group's strategic archiving tool. So there's not normally a debate about, well, what are we going to use? It's just seems, it's accepted now as if there's an archive requirement, the default is Solix.
Okay, thank you. Mark, could you talk about these two questions?
Sure. So the second one first, I think in terms of adoption, we had it in our minds that once our finance archival solution was in play, that we would be able to leverage that into more organic adoption. And I think even in a relatively short amount of time, we see that happening. And just for everyone's context, we were able to get the Solix Finance Archival Solution platform up and running within 90 days. So I think in terms of velocity, just-in-time capabilities, just-in-time training, all of that, we're huge benefits. And I think, again, the largest selling point for Solex is an integrated platform and services solution, just add water solution. In terms of business case, it was pretty straightforward. We had fairly significant costs in retaining a legacy platform and also the associated staffing and infrastructure. So I think, you know, our guidepost was make it work quickly, make sure that we had, for the amount of use that we would need to deploy the archival solution, make sure that it was as significantly more cost effective than retaining our legacy platform and the associated staff and infrastructure. I think that's pretty much it. We had buy-in from all the way up through our CFO on this. So as far as being able to sell it and a business case, it was we had buy-in from the outset. And I'll loop back on our functional requirements. I think in terms of adoption, we reached out to our principal user communities of the legacy systems to make sure that our 2B requirements really were not something that we would impose on them, but they helped us write the requirement that ultimately would lead to adoption. So I think that not only made sure that we were in compliance, but that we also had more of an adoption glide path.
Excellent. Thank you. Gary.
Well, much similar to the other gentleman who spoke, but I'll add a few things. You know, we have a corporate data retention policy that's in place that we follow, and so there was never not much of a discussion on the need to do this, whether it was regulatory compliance or just from the cost of variation and variability and how that plays into an overall roadmap and dilute your resource base, both financial and from a personal point of view, a personnel point of view. So, you know, we really needed to build a case for a single solution, kind of a one-stop shop that we would establish as a strategic platform. And in doing that, we leveraged that value equation and then set out to standardize that one-stop shop against our current data standard.
Okay. Great. Thank you. And just as a reminder to the audience, if you are thinking about questions that you'd like to pose to the panelists, please enter those as a chat to me, and I'll make sure in just a few minutes when we get to that section that to pose those questions. So let's shift gears a little bit and talk about actual deployment and implementation. And first, I'm curious about your approach for deployment. I know I've heard Mark talk about cloud. Just curious as to the approach you decided to take to deploy the solution, whether it was, you know, on-premise, on existing infrastructure, outsourced infrastructure, cloud infrastructure, and your thought process behind that decision. So, Mark, let me start with you on this one.
Sure. It's been a strategic directive with the CIO and yours truly to really look at cloud as not only a future state, but a current state platform for Avery Dennison wherever it was feasible. And I think this is one of those practical applications where, because this is primarily going to be store, retrieve, and report with immutable data, it seemed like cloud for both data and application would be a viable choice. This is not a system that would be used for 9, 10, 11, or 12 hours throughout the day. This is something that gets episodic use, heavy use when it's needed, but episodic use nonetheless. So I think it was part of our overall strategic direction to pursue cloud-based solutions. I will say, having said that, that with our organic adoption, we already have one other solution based in Europe that's currently using deployed and using Solex on-prem solution. They're doing a lot of real-time streaming of data as an alternative. So I think that's another unique part of the Solex platform, that it gives you the flexibility for either cloud or on-prem. For us, going to a third-party cloud provider was the first of a kind. In our case, we went to AWS with Amazon. I think a couple of meaningful lessons learned, but nothing that really stretched out or delayed the project. So I think we were able to combine a couple of successes there, institute an archival solution platform as a standard, and be able to push that to a third-party cloud provider.
And Mark, a follow-up on that. How did you find the economics of the cloud option compared to the on-premise alternatives that you guys considered?
Yeah, I don't. Thanks, Mark, for that. I don't think there's any comparison because as soon as we talk about on-prem, we're talking about servers being hosted in our data center. So we not only have the hardware costs, but we also have our service provider costs. We have connectivity. We've got our internal staff responsible for caring, feeding the solutions. So I think we really need to do a lift from that and really try and push the cloud as a cost benefit and also as a service benefit as well. Not only shifting the cost, but also shifting the risk.
Understand. Okay, great. Thank you. Gary, could you talk about the approach for deployment that you guys took at Stanley?
We took a conservative approach because of data security, and I realize there are SOC 2 Type 2 cloud-based out there, and we do leverage them. But to get in earnest to get the project up and running and to get started very quickly, we put it on-premise, and we're now looking at the possibility of moving it out. But it was a conservative approach. It's working very well. We are concerned about the economics behind that approach, and we're considering cloud-based going forward.
Okay. Okay, great. And Richard?
I think with Santander, our default is to put systems on our own infrastructure, so that's what we've done. I'm not aware of any, I'm not sure that we generally sort of consider anything else. That's the norm.
Okay, great. Well, thank you.
Mark, just one more footnote on this. I will say that while Avery Dennison is an 80-year-old manufacturing company, and in terms of both process and IT policies, we have followed, like colleagues, a very strict and conservative approach. I think this is an opportunity for us to step out a little bit and see exactly how feasible it was. And we measured the risk and the reward pretty carefully along the way. We had some control gate factors in the project that would allow us some alternatives should the need arise. But I think the end state of it was very successful.
Great, thank you. So the next question I wanted to get into was on your implementation, and I'm curious about the decision whether you would build this in-house as a core competency, whether you see archiving in that sense, or whether you see this more as an activity that you wanted to outsource. And if you did that approach, talk about how that worked. Let me start with Gary on this one.
Well, we have kind of a scalable approach with outsource, and we have a global thought leader in our corporation that works directly for me, who is responsible for the health and well-being as well as the architecture of our program. He then works for regionally deployed people that are Stanley Black & Decker people. We then take the technology and the technical aspects of this thing, and we would outsource that. Our global thought leader is responsible for a playbook, which is a standard offering for archival. Each project is then looked at against that standard offering and determined that there's gaps against that standard offering, which we would then build, or at least put the requirements together to be built for additional reporting and additional data storage for whatever system we intend to archive. The approach itself is something that has played very well with where we're at because people can come in and criticize and be critical of the playbook itself. But at the end of the day, we're giving them a straw man and here's what you get out of the box kind of thing, which is just executable and repeated.
Thank you. Richard, how did you guys approach the implementation?
We basically had the initial project had 10 systems to archive. And what we did was we picked the ones that were lowest usage and used those effectively as the guinea pigs. We had a period where we had Solix consultancy on site. We did have an issue with that due to a visa, but we got around that with WebEx sessions. So we used Solix consultants to train our own developers, and that took place during the early stages of the initial project. We got, I think it was about four archives built with a lot of help from the consultant, and then as the project wore on, we became more dependent on our own developers, and by the end of the project, our developers were pretty familiar with what they needed to do, and were a lot less reliant on the consultants. And right at the very end, I think we no longer had any consultancy. It was our developers doing all the work, possibly with the occasional call to the Solix support help desk if they needed it. So that's how we implemented it initially.
Great. So it sounds like you guys developed self-sufficiency within your in-house organization. That's great. And
yep.
Mark, how did you guys approach the implementation?
Great question, Mark. Unlike my colleagues, we really didn't have, even though we do have a catalog services offering for IT, this was not among them. So we really had to build an operational model from the ground up on this. So I think it was an extraordinary experience, a lot of help from Solix, but our intent was to be able to build a scalable, repeatable process, be able to have enough core knowledge in-house to be able to help not only train end users, but be able to develop and deploy subsequent archival solutions. So we nominated and are in the process of lifting up one of our senior IT business analysts, who's also a developer, to be the central point of contact. We have another central point of contact within our infrastructure services. Obviously, our network and security folks, since we're doing both on-prem and cloud, are key to make sure that we've got access controls and, in the case of the cloud, good cybersecurity in place. So we've now built a core operational model service offering for this and training folks in-house. We had a combination of on-site for the initial kickoff of our implementation with subsequent WebEx and online sessions. So kind of a blended model. But our intent is ultimately to be able to support the platform internally with occasional as-needed support from Solix. That's the way forward.
Excellent. Well, thank you for that one. Let's talk about the results. So did the results meet your expectations? I know some of you are still in process with your projects, so you've only got partial results so far. But maybe just talk about what you've seen. And let me go to Richard for this one first.
Okay, we implemented Solix roughly 2 years ago, around about Q2 2013. The initial project was around about 6 months. So, by the end of those 6 months, we had 10 archives in place. And since then, we found is that projects come along where we are migrating systems from a system that's been in use for some time to another system, and quite often there's no appetite to archive or to migrate all the historic data. So we now see projects where there's a migration of one system to another, and part of that project is archiving of historic data to Solix. So we've now had quite a number of those, and we're now at the stage where we have in the region of 20 source systems archive in Solix. The feedback, I think quite often the sign of quality is no news or not hearing anything, and that's what goes on with Solix. We get very little in terms of incidents raised with Solix or complaints, and I think generally the users get used to it very quickly and are quite happy with it. So we recently implemented a very large system that had quite a lot of recent data that was archived in Solix, and that had an enormous increase in the volume of queries that were run on a daily basis. We had a bit of an issue with that because I don't think the system was configured to deal with that volume, but we contacted the Solix support help desk, and I think within probably 3 or 4 days we'd reconfigured, and we now, just to give you an idea, the volume of queries for the previous 18 or so archives increased by somewhere in the region of over 5,000% with that one, with the addition of that one archive. So huge increase in the volumes of queries, but you know we managed to resolve that issue very quickly, and yeah, overall I think our experience is very, very good with Solix.
Great, thank you for that. Mark, could you talk about the results you guys have seen so far?
Sure. So as Mark alluded to, some of us are more in flight than others, and as I mentioned, we had the project up and running inside of 12 weeks for our initial finance applications. We're in the final test phases now, end user acceptance. I would say at this point, this is really about understanding first-of-kind issues. I think it's really about more user education and training than supportability or operational issues. I think Solix has been, to that end, a superb partner in helping us make sure that we have a reliable and highly available and scalable platform. The other three pieces of flexibility having to do with being able to store static reporting as files, being able to do ad hoc queries and also predefined queries gives our finance team globally a lot of flexibility in how they source and report out on data. One of our data structures had in excess of 14 years of data, so you can imagine the volume of data required there and the amount of retrieval capabilities that's going to be necessary along the way, but I'd say so far very, very high marks along the way.
Great, thank you, and I'll wrap up this one with Gary.
Yeah, we've had similar successes. I guess to date we've had six systems that have been decommissioned with Solix. We have six in process now and 15 planned for 2015. And as you can imagine, based on our strategy, we have a strategic alignment with our strategic plan and the roadmap, project roadmap. To that end, we're attempting to decouple the dependency of a project being completed and the actual start of the decommissioning effort. So we've got, based on that, we can actually flat load and predict you know, how many we can do each year in response to the roadmap and the retirement of systems. We also received very good reviews from our users. They like the tool. And going forward, I think the standard offering, we're at about 6 to 8 weeks from start to end of a decommissioning program with Solix. And I look for that to be very predictable. And in our business, predictability is a very, very good thing, and both from a cost and from a time standpoint.
Great, thank you. And the last topic before we open it up for Q&A is just about lessons learned. So again, I remind the audience, if you do have questions for the panelists, please submit them to me via chat. And so Mark, tell us what lessons have you guys learned so far?
I would say on the good side, Mark, that our functional requirements really held us in good stead. For those on the call, we use those as the foundation for both our RFI and RFE process. It allowed us to get to Solex as our champion solution a lot quicker, and I would also say to their credit, they answered every line item within the RFI and RFP to the letter. It allowed us to identify them as the ideal solution provider as well. I would say in terms of lessons learned, we did a series of events here as a first of a kind. One, this is our first major investment in a true archival solution. So I think Solex has made it a real glide path there. I would say an area in which you can't invest enough time and energy is making sure that you get your end user community on board with what the proposed solution is, what's going to be look like, and really set those expectations from the outset. And you'll get a lot more buy-in and a lot less heartburn, especially on support. And third, if you're considering the cloud, I think it's a very viable solution. If you're doing it for the first time with a third-party provider, allow a little bit of extra time. You're going to come across first instance bumps in the road that we all love to be predictive and be able to stick with our plans. And I think if you put in a little extra contingency in your plans, when you push it outside, you'll be in good stead.
Great, thank you. Gary, lessons learned at Stanley Black & Decker?
Yeah, data, data, data. If there's a devil in the mix, it's in the data. It's either special characters or double byte Chinese characters or things that that are going to go bump in the night that you don't expect. The other thing is, you know, you need to do the archiving as close to the planned retirement date as possible so that you can ensure the resources that understand the data, understand the system, understand the infrastructure and the schemas are still there and you still have access to them going forward. The ERP data, the data in systems that is record-oriented is easy. Where you get into the challenges are PDFs and Word documents, Excel, and TIFF files, and JPEGs, and all the other different data types that are out there that are a little more challenging to retain, and you need to plan accordingly for those. And the other thing is that, you know, the playbook was established probably two projects, maybe three projects into the cycle of decommissioning. Absolutely a must for predictability and standardization and the iteration over that playbook as you do a gap analysis for what's missing in the playbook, you add it to the playbook for the next offering. So we get better and better, I think, with our standard offering, and I think that's something we could have started a little bit earlier.
Excellent. And Richard?
I think some of the lessons learned are, I would say, having that initial consultancy was invaluable, you know, for our building our self-sufficiency. So well worth the investment if that's the route you want to go. We very early on came up with a standard process, which we've fine-tuned a little bit as we've gone, but basically we're still using that. And that gives us, you know, very... A template just to follow for each archive. So I'm not sure, I think it might have been Gary was saying, you know, they have a standard turnaround of around about 8 weeks. I think with us, I think we turn around archives generally probably in about a 12-week duration. But I still, I think in terms of a benefit, you know, the alternatives would probably be longer and probably cost more. We also have the benefit of a very senior business sponsor, which I think helps. So you know, every so often I can say, well, I'm sorry, but so-and-so says, you know, this is the strategic solution, so that's the route we're going to go. I think they're the ones that come to mind. There are probably quite a few others. The doubling of data that I think Gary mentioned, that's quite useful because we have had occasionally had an issue with the problem on the creating the new archive database, and the doubling of the data does quite often resolve that issue. So yeah, okay, I think that's it from me.
Great. Well, thank you all. So let's look at some questions. We've just got a few minutes, but time for a couple of questions at least. So the first one that's come in is about reporting, and you know, what are some of the use case drive your reporting requirements? Are they coming from, you know, your audit team, your tax team, or just general purpose business reporting requirements? What's driving the reporting requirements for you guys? Mark, could you start with that one?
Sure, Mark. I would say primarily it's going to be tax audit and reg compliance, because we're talking about financial information here. So I think those definitions were clearly articulated in requirements, and there really haven't been any surprises there. I would say it's a combination of answering this question and a footnote to the previous. When you go out and reach out to your community, depending on the nature of the data, make sure you pull all of the folks that you expect to be conspicuous consumers of the information and go beyond. So for example, in addition to our finance team, we also reached out to mergers acquisitions. We reached out to legal to make sure that along the way, any auditable information that might be useful in merger acquisition activity would be readily retrievable and in the proper reporting format. Again, same with legal. So make sure your constituency reaches a broad base. But reporting was pretty well defined as a result of our constituency and their need.
And Richard, what about with Santander? What drives the report requirements for you guys?
Right, and by reporting, do we mean the data retrieval requirements?
Yes, or, exactly. Yeah, the data queries, data retrieval, exactly.
Well, typically we have dealt with numerous departments across the bank. I agree with, I think it was Mark, you've got to make sure that you do go to all the various areas. I think on one or two archives, it's almost difficult to actually identify all of the areas that use an existing system. And, you know, somebody shouts out at the last minute, what about our area? So, But generally speaking, we identify the areas up front. We get the areas to agree what the reporting requirements are, and of course they are typically based on the requirements from the existing source system. So that's usually the basis on which the SOX reports are made.
Okay. I think I've got time for just one more question. Let me pose this one to Gary. So have you set up your organization so that, and your system, so that users can run their own reports, or do they have to come to someone in an IT organization or IT role and request the data and have the IT person run the report for them?
No, we have our users. We have about 88 users and growing on a regular basis at this point, and we allow the users to run standard reports that were developed and are in there. And if they want anything else, then they can come to the IT organization to get additional reports created.
Okay, excellent. Well, we have come to the end of our hour, and I want to thank, on behalf of Solix and everyone that's participated, our panelists. Thank you very much for your contribution, and I'd also like to thank all the audience members for listening to the presentation. And if you'd like more information about Solix, you can find us at solix.com. And thank you very much, and look forward to hearing from some of you.